I'm Emma Peel, and I've decided to pay a visit to one of my fellow PBS announcers, Lyndelle Wilkinson. You'll hear her dulcet tones over the airwaves on Wednesday evenings for her program, The Afterglow. But did you also know that she used to host a breakfast spread? I decided perhaps I'll spend the afternoon with her and figure out what lies within the depths of her record collection. Let's go! Hello?
Come into my house.
Sure, let's go. All right, Lyndelle. In 10 words or less, can you sum up your musical taste?
I have written this down about 3 different ways, but I think it's got to include how it makes you feel. So, bum shaking, hip chasing, heart racing, catchy, and... Something heavy.
Yeah, nice.
Anything with considerable heft that makes you move.
Yeah, that's great. Yeah. Can you tell me about the first album that you ever bought and why you bought it?
My first real album I ever bought was Dragon. I think it's Rain. I don't know. That song was on it, but my sister really wanted it and she had no money, so I was forced to buy that. So I don't consider that my first album.
All right.
But it is the first official one that I bought. But my first album that I bought was actually on tape, and it was Madonna's Madonna.
Perfect. Classic. And what about the most recent album that you've bought?
Most recent album is a really interesting album that a guy called Yasin Bey has released, and it's Mos Def. And doing great stuff over Marvin Gaye.
Yes, yes. Beautiful. I've played that on the breakfast spread a couple of times.
There you go. That's the most recent one.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's delightful. And it really highlights how beautiful Marvin Gaye's vocal is with that soulful sound and how interesting then something going over the top that's got nothing to do with that style. It just works. It's great.
It's pretty clever. Mm. Now, what's an album that you've bought that unexpectedly blew your mind?
Quite recently was a disco album, but I've got to say probably the one that really got me was back in the 90s when I had no idea who Jeff Buckley was. And I heard people talking about this, Jeff Buckley. And I heard people talking who were from completely different musical genre backgrounds. So it was someone who really liked jazz and someone who really liked pop. And I remember thinking, if so many different people are talking about this guy, I really need to hear this album. I was quite late to him. And I got Grace, and I don't think I turned that album off for a year. And it hasn't dated for me at all. And it also, it just seems to cross over all emotions. Like there's anger in there, and there's real vulnerability in there. There's beautiful love. There's total isolation. Like it just seems to cross all emotion. And within 5 minutes, every track seems to be able to carry that. And I just love it.
Is that something listeners can expect to hear in the afterglow, perhaps?
No. I can't say I've thought about even bringing him in on the afterglow, probably because he's just... It's probably too emotional. Mm. The afterglow is a little bit more one emotion, which is that very comfortable and almost like day 3 of your holidays.
Yeah.
And you've definitely gotten into the groove of switching off. That, for me, is the afterglow.
Because I guess most of your listeners would, a large portion of them would probably be driving home, so you don't want anyone crying.
Yeah. No.
As they're changing into
Unless
top gear.
Happy, it's true.
You don't want that.
No. No crying,
okay.
Please.
So no Jeff Buckley.
No.
Okay. Can you tell me if your house was burning down, which, you know, touch wood, that never happens.
No.
But if it was to happen and you could only take one record, what would it be?
It's the worst question ever.
Thanks.
Because you look at this and you go, okay, so you're standing in this fire and it's crazy and you're looking through. No. I think the smartest answer would be the most expensive so that you could get out, sell it, and then rebuild your entire record collection from it. But I have no expensive album. Like the most expensive album I have is an $80 album that I bought when I was over in San Fran recently, which is the funniest album. It's the soundtrack to Deep Throat.
Oh,
the movie.
Yeah.
And it's cost me $80 and the guy's like, we never see it, never see it coming. But I don't think that'd be the one I'd grab. Probably I'd grab the sentimental favourite, which is the very first bit of vinyl that I bought after Chris Gill brought it into the breakfast spread, and I fell in love with it so much. And I said, oh, do you have it on CD? He's like, and he looked at me as if I'd spat on his grave. Are you serious? So the only way I could get this album was having it on vinyl. And, gosh, I've got it right here. It's beautiful. It's a single, and it's out of New Zealand, and it's just this instrumental. It's Electric Wire Hustle, and it's an art track called Perception.
Okay.
There's nothing very fancy about it other than it's a sentimental favourite.
Yeah, cool.
Yeah.
All right. Now, a lot of people, you know, certainly that I've run across that are vinyl collectors have their thing, but then they also tend to have something that they keep right at the back of the record cupboard that, you know, they're a bit too cool to let on about that they actually enjoy.
Right.
So I'm wondering whether, if I was to go through your vast record collection here, I'd find any
terrible stuff. You would find some horrific things.
Any Cat Stevens, Paul Kidney revealed Cat Stevens.
That doesn't surprise me. It doesn't surprise me. That would be in there. For me, yeah, there's some really terrible 80s compilations, like those, you know, 84 with a Bullet. There's stuff like that. There's Hall & Oates.
Hey, I dig Hall & Oates.
Thank you.
Yeah.
But okay. I'm a total dag. I don't think I've ever tried to hide my dagginess at all.
Me neither.
Probably the funniest stuff that's in there. You're a good dag, though. You're a classy dag. So I've got this section that no one would expect me to have, which is musicals. And they're all my dad's musicals. So he, in the 80s, was a musical theatre performer. And so I remember as a child going and seeing him perform. And when he passed away, he had this collection of musical and vinyl. So I don't listen to it because I've got no interest, but I look at it. For me, it's almost like it's an audio sort of photo album because I look at it and I think of him singing,
yeah.
But I never play them. But it's this funny little section in my record collection which people would look at going, really? It's like, I'm like, not really. It's sentimental. So that's a funny thing. But there's some pretty bad 80s in there. I'm a girl born in 74, so I'm a total 80s girl. But no Kylie Minogue.
Okay, good to know.
Yeah.
Now, I was wondering when it's quiet in here, there's no one around, and you're cranking up the tunes, is there one song that you put on and dance around to in the living room by yourself?
Yes. It's Curtis Mayfield's Move On Up.
Classic.
It will make me dance no matter where I am. We could be at a restaurant and if that came on, chair back, I'm up. I don't have to be on my own. I could be anywhere.
Well, maybe we should have a dance to it now. What do you say?
Hey?
You're on.
Hush, not child. Might understand.